for gathering here today on this very auspicious occasion of Sri Nrisingha Chaturdasi, the Transcendental Parents Day of Lord Narasimhadev. We are very honored here in South Florida to have our special guest who's here, coming from the spiritual world, directly from Vrindavan, the founder of the Bhakti movement here, international, and also our Srila Gurudev for so many thousands of devotees here in the Gaudiya Sampradaya. So without further ado, we'd like to give our congratulations and welcomes to Sri Bhakti Vedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj, Srila Gurudev Ki. We'd also acknowledge all of the Padmanabh Maharaj and Bhakti Madhava Maharaj, Rajanath, and all the senior Vaishnavas here and Vaishnavis here, coming together, and all the guests, we welcome you and thank you for coming to hear this transcendental Kata, Hare Kata, Lord Nrisingadev, given by Srila Gurudev. Hare Krishna.
Chaturdashi, and this is a very sacred festival which is being celebrated all throughout the world today, the Divine Appearance Day of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in His very amazing transcendental form of Lord Nrisingha Bhagavan. Today we will be very fortunate to hear about this pastime from our Srila Gurudev and the assembled Vaishnavas, from the ancient Srimad Bhagavatam. So before we begin, we will offer prayers to Lord Nrisingadev.
I hear the same. Yeah. Markandeya Rishi was waiting here and there, no saying nothing in the boat of Matsya Devi, with all ships of world taking there. And after when it was finished, then he took out the swine room and he gave, and again this world was created. Second, Kurma Mata. Tato incarnation came. Why? To take amrita, nectar from ocean. And then he took mantaracha utarva, very heavy mountain mantaracha on his back. Then by Sheshna, and then so many things came. And then Dhanvantari came with a pot of
nectar.
And so many things were there. Then he came in the form of Shukra.
Four
incarnations. Then he came in the form of Vishnu. After that, Parshuram. After that, Shivam. And after that, Balaram. And after that, Kalki. These are all incarnation of Sri Krishna himself. It's so that as in creation, development of creation, first water, in water,
floating in water
only. And then second,
water and land both.
And third, only both in land. And fifth, half man and half land. Like a jungle jaguar. And then he became Parshuram, like a white person killing here and there.
Parshuram.
Oh, Vamandev. Oh, in a very
rough
war. Not full. After that, Parshuram came in full man, but white person. Then Ram came, Marjada Purushottam. You know Marjada Purushottam? To establish
etiquette
in this world. And after that, Baladev Prabhu came with Havka,
with plow.
And he pulled Jamuna. Where you are going? Come in my yard and felt the thoughts of my most beloved Guru. And then Kalki came.
Buddha.
That don't keep animals in fire sacrifices. And then Kalki Devta. Kill all demon persons and to establish again Kshatriya in this way. Krishna, Supreme Lord, Supreme Personality of God, sometimes come himself, sometimes sent all conditions. Today is Nisimha Charaturdashi, birthday of Nisimha. Hiranyakashipu, in his previous birth, he was Jaya and Vijay by the cause of Lakshmi Devi and both was. He came as a demon, Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyakashipu. Then all Evilan died in water, in land, in
sky,
sky, or by any man created by
Brahma
and by Evilan died.
Any weapon,
not in the side of home, not outside. So many.
Not any month. Nothing living or dead.
Yeah. So they can pay water. But in his adjacent, very powerful devotees of God, Supreme Lord, came. There was some whatever between them, and he wanted to kill Prahlad, but Nisimha came and killed his Hiranyakashipu and saved Prahlad. So we will explain all these things. Will have to learn something from Prahlad Maharaj if you really want to do bhajan. As he was tolerant, very humble, nirbhik,
bold, very bold,
not caring for anyone, even not caring for his day. Always remembering Supreme Lord. So how? First, Padmanabha Maharaj will explain.
First of all, I'm offering my unlimited dandavat pranams and my shraddha pushpanjali, the flower offerings of faith from my heart, to the lotus feet of my beloved Gurudev Nityalila Pravishta Om Vishnupad Ashto Tarasata Sri Srila Esi Bhaktivedanta Swami Maharaj Srila Prabhupada. And secondly, I'm offering my equal dandavat pranams and my shraddha pushpanjali to the lotus feet of my beloved Siksha Gurus, instructing spiritual masters, Khan. His divine grace Nitya Lila Prabhishtam Vishnu Pad Sri Srila Bhakti Rakshak Sri Har Goswami Maharaj. And His divine grace Om Vishnupad Asto Tarasata Sri Srila Bhakti Vedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj, whom we are so fortunate this evening to be in the divine presence of in this auspicious assembly. So, Srila Gurudev has ordered me to begin the narration of the pastime of the appearance of God Himself on this holy blessed day, Nrisimha Chaturdashi, as Srila Gurudev was just now describing to us. From the beginning of our universe, the Supreme Absolute Truth, who is the source of this universe, who is the creator of everything, the maintainer of everything, and the destroyer of everything. We generally say G-O-D, God. But G, the letter G stands for generator, he who creates this universe. O stands for operator, and D for the destroyer of this universe. So actually, God signifies that supreme being who is the absolute truth behind everything. And that supreme absolute truth who has created everything by his own divine power, he can at his sweet will anytime come within this universe. So those appearances of the Supreme Lord within this universe, they're narrated in the ancient literatures called the Vedas. And specifically, amongst those Vedic literatures, there is one great literature written 5,000 years ago called Srimad Bhagavatam. And the Srimad Bhagavatam is the final record and the final essence of all spiritual teachings on this planet. So, whatever is being discussed this evening, it is coming from this authoritative source of divine knowledge. So in that Srimad Bhagavatam, it is narrated this story of the very great devotee Prahlad Maharaj, who was just a very young boy. His father's name was Hiranyakashipu. His father was actually of the demoniac mentality. In Sanskrit language, it is called Asura. Asura means someone who is not inclined toward God, or an atheistic person. And Sura means someone who is always having complete faith and dependence upon God. So in this case, Hiranyakashipu was a very powerful and great demon. But his son was quite the opposite. Although he was a prince, his son, the son of a great king, but Prahlad Maharaj was a pure devotee of Krishna from his very birth. How this came to be is explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Once, this great personality, this demon, Hiranyakashipu, he had a very strong desire that he wanted to become immortal. We know that everyone in this world who takes birth, he will certainly have to die one day. That is the law of nature. And there is nothing which is more absolutely certain than this. If we have taken our birth, one day we are going to die. But the demoniac persons, they want to somehow or other defeat this law of nature. So Hiranyakashipu decided that he would go and perform very, very severe austerities and penances. This was many, many thousands and millions of years ago in our universe. And in those times, it was called Satya Yuga. The people used to live for thousands of years actually. Not like today in this present age of Kali Yuga, people can live for maybe maximum 100 years. So Hiranyakashipu decided to devote a good amount of time to perform austerities. Why? So that he could call the subordinate creator of this universe, Lord Brahma, who receives his power from the Supreme Lord, to come down. So Hiranyakashipu stood on the tips of his toes with his arms upraised for thousands of years. And at the end of his austerities, Lord Brahma came down on his swan carrier. And at that time, he sprinkled some water on the body of Hiranyakashipu because his body had become completely eaten by ants as he was standing there. Only the bones were remaining. And when he sprinkled some water on him, immediately he had a very powerful new body. So Hiranyakashipu, he immediately bowed down to Lord Brahma, and Lord Brahma said, "What benedictions would you like?" He said, "I want to become immortal." So then Lord Brahma told him, "Actually, I cannot give you this kind of benediction because I myself am not immortal." So then Hiranyakashipu thought, "Oh, okay." And he had a very clever plan. "Then give me the benediction that I will not die in the day or in the night."
"That's right."
And then Lord Brahma said, "That's all right." And then he said, "Okay, now give me the benediction that I will not die on the land, on the sea, or in the air." And he said, "That's quite fair." He gave him the benediction. Then he said, "Give me the benediction that I will not die by any man-made creature, man or beast, within your creation." And he said, "This is the least that I can do." And he gave him that benediction. Then he thought, "Oh, let me not be able to die by any man-made weapon." And he said, "Yes, I can approve of this." So in this way, through so many very intelligent proposals, Hiranyakashipu thought, "Yes, now I've covered all ground." And now he raised his hands in the air. And he said, "I am immortal!" So we will find out how immortal he was in this narration this evening. So now, actually during this time, the higher planetary systems, the demigods who live there, they're very powerful beings. They also lived for millions of years. And they became very concerned because this demon was becoming very powerful. From the beginning of our universe, we find in the Vedas that there are always battles between these two forces of good and evil. It is going on constantly in this universe. So the demigods, they thought, "Oh, the queen, the wife of this demon, is pregnant. So we should kidnap her and we should take her away. And the child within her womb, certainly he will also be a very great demon. So we should kill that child." And they went secretly to the palace of Hiranyakashipu while he was gone away. And they took this wife of his, and they were taking her away. But at that moment they were stopped by a very great spiritual personality named Narada Muni. Sri Narada Muni, he is a transcendental traveler. Always he is going throughout the entire creation. He is a servant of the Supreme Lord. And he is the greatest of all the spiritual masters in our universe. So Narada Muni stopped the demigods and he told them, "No, no, you should not kill this child in the womb because actually he's a very great pure devotee. So I will take him to my ashram. I will take the mother there." And Narada Muni took her to his ashram. And during that time, he narrated, he spoke divine spiritual wisdom and so many explanations of the past times and the activities of the Supreme Lord. And the child who was within the womb, he was also hearing. So therefore, that child who was the son of Hiranyakashipu named Prahlad Maharaj, from the very moment that he took birth from the womb, he was actually a pure devotee, a divine soul. So now, Hiranyakashipu returned to his palace, but before that, they brought the mother of Prahlad Maharaj, they brought his queen there. And because she was like in a mystic trance, she did not remember any of this. So now, Prahlad Maharaj, living in the very opulent surroundings of this palace of his father, Hiranyakashipu had actually, after he received these benedictions, he went throughout the universe and he terrorized everywhere and he conquered in all directions. All the demigods began fleeing here and there. And now Hiranyakashipu sat on the very throne of the king of the heavenly planets, Lord Indra. And he now took charge and took control of the entire universe. So powerful he was. So Prahlad Maharaj, he was one of the four sons of Hiranyakashipu, but he was especially favored by his father. And when he was around 5 years of age, he was sent to school to learn the basic teachings that all the demoniac persons want their children to learn, like diplomacy, politics, how to be hypocrisy, how to conquer enemies, how to control others. So he wanted that his son would be educated from early childhood so that he could take over the kingdom and become a demoniac ruler like him. So when his son was first sent to school, then one day his mother brought Prahlad, very nicely dressed, very nicely decorated, and brought Prahlad to his father Hiranyakashipu, who was sitting on the throne. And at that time, when Hiranyakashipu saw his beautiful young son, now his heart became melted. You see, even demoniac persons, their hearts will melt for their own children, but for others, oh, their hearts will be as hard as a thunderbolt. So in this case, Hiranyakashipu, he took Prahlad on his lap, and now he looked at his son with great affection. And just like any parent, when their child comes back from the first day of school, so what does the parents usually ask their child? Oh, what did you learn today? Please tell me. So now, Hiranyakashipu asks Prahlad, said, Prahlad, please tell me, what is the best teaching that you have learned in school? Please explain that to me. So Prahlad, he looked at his father, and he didn't say, my dear father. He said, oh, best of the demons. He said, tatsadumanye asuravarya dehina sadasamudvignadiya sadgrahat hitvatma patam grihamandakupam So this very famous verse is spoken by Prahlad to his father. There is very deep teachings within this statement of Prahlad Maharaj. He said, oh, my dear father, dear king of the demons, tatsadu manye asuravarya dehina sada sumudvigna diya asatrihat. He said, I think that the very best knowledge, the best thing that I have learned is that all living beings who are here within this material world, who are suffering because they have accepted this temporary material body, and they have accepted the process of repeated birth, death, disease, old age, and they are constantly full of so many anxieties because of accepting this temporary world as their real home. Because actually all of us, we are not these physical bodies. This temporary physical body is only a creation of the five elements of this material world, earth, water, fire, air, ether. And what is the body actually? It's simply a bag of so many things like blood, bones, and stool and urine and so many things we don't want to even mention. But yet, we hold this material body, we think that this is our very own self. But actually, this knowledge is very low level. It is very deeply sunk in ignorance for someone to think that I am this temporary physical body. Actually, everyone within this world is an eternal spiritual being. And our soul is living lifetime after lifetime in millions of lives. So Prahlad Maharaj, because he was a very exalted, pure soul, he understood this truth, and he told to his father, he said, I think the best knowledge is that a person who has accepted this temporary body, this temporary world, as the real home, as their real place, as permanent, trying to make a permanent situation here, like Hiranyakashipu trying to become immortal, he said, I think that the best thing that they should do Hitvatvapatam Brihamandakupam. They should immediately give up this temporary illusory condition of life in this world. And Vanamgato Yadharimashayeta. They should go to the transcendental place, the forest of Vrindavan, where they can worship Krishna, the Supreme Lord, and there they can have their heart's desire eternally fulfilled. So, Prahlad Maharaj told this to Hiranyakashipu. What is the meaning of this? Oh, there is a very nice story which has been told to explain how someone in this world is in a very precarious condition, like each one of us. So one day, there was a man, and he was walking through a jungle. The jungle was very beautiful, so many beautiful trees and flowers, and he was enjoying the atmosphere of this jungle. As he was walking along, very anxiety-free, suddenly he heard a sound. He turned and he looked, and there he saw a tiger with his eyes fixed on him from a distance, his mouth gaping jaws wide open and roaring and licking his lips because he was now seeing some food in front of him. So that man, immediately his heart began to pound and he became very, very frightened. And immediately he began to run very quickly. And as he began to run, now he saw that the tiger also began to run behind him. The man was running faster, faster, trying to get away from the tiger. Tiger was getting closer and closer, and he's breathing very hard. Looking everywhere, where can I go? Where can I hide? Where can I climb? And suddenly he saw in front of him a dark well. It was covered by some grass, but he could see that he could go down into this well, and in this way he could save himself. And he tried to figure out, how can I go down? And he suddenly saw that above the well, there was a tree hanging, and there were two branches that were also hanging over the well. So he grabbed hold of these two branches, and now he lowered himself down into the well, and he was half hanging down into the well. When he looked down below him, he saw so many snakes at the bottom. And he thought, oh no, my God, what will I do now? He couldn't go down. And then he looked up, and suddenly above, at the top of the well, he saw the face of the tiger looking down at him. So the man was hanging there by two branches, and he was thinking to himself, what can I do? But then, as he was looking, he noticed that there were two rats on the two branches. One was white color, the other was black color, and they were chewing on the branches. So what did this mean? This means that gradually the branches are going to be eaten through, and he's going to fall down into the pit. So then he was even more discouraged, and now he thought, oh, what can I do? But he saw one more thing above his head, and just on the branch that was hanging over, there was a bee's nest, honeybees. And this honeycomb was oozing some honey out of the honeycomb. So as he looked up, he noticed that this honeycomb was just dripping a couple of drops down, and it was just near to his face as he was hanging there holding onto the two branches. And so when he saw the couple of drops hanging, coming down in front of his face, he thought, oh, let me try to taste this. So he leaned forward and he stuck his tongue out of his mouth, and a couple of drops just came on the tip of his tongue. And then he said, oh, how sweet. And for a moment, he forgot what was his condition. Just for that moment, he forgot. What is the moral of this story? What is the meaning? This is what Prahlad Maharaj was trying to teach to his father, Hiranyakashipu. Who is the person who is running through this forest? It is you, and you, and me, and all of us in this world. Why? Because this forest is like the world of enjoyment of this temporary illusory world. And in this forest, we're trying to enjoy the atmosphere. But as we're trying to enjoy, there is something that's always looming behind us. And what is that? Imminent death in the form of this tiger. And this imminent death is always approaching closer, closer, closer. So now, he came to the well. What is this well? Oh, this is the so-called security that we think that we can find by going into the well of what is called household life, materialistic life in this world. We think that if we surround ourselves by our family, by our friends, by our... Oh, we're safe. Just like this man thought, I will lower myself into this well, I'll be safe. So, but when he looked down below, he also saw that this is a very poor predicament, because why? So many snakes trying to bite. What are the snakes? This is the miseries of this material existence constantly coming to us in the form of three types of miseries. The miseries that come from our body and mind. The miseries that come from nature. Too much cold, too much heat, too much rain, too little rain. The miseries that come from natural catastrophes like earthquakes, tornadoes, hurricanes. Here's Hurricane Center of America, Florida. So all these miseries, and also old age and diseases. So in this way, oh, at every moment we are being bitten, bitten, bitten. So, but as we're in this so-called safe condition, and we're hanging on to these two branches. What are the two branches? This is our, each one of our duration of life. We don't know how long it is. No one in this room can write down on a piece of paper, I have 10 more years. No one can guarantee this. Not a young person, not an old person. No one knows. But one thing we know, it's temporary. So therefore, those two branches indicate that we're holding on and our duration of life is decreasing. How? Because of two rats, one white, one black, day and night. And chewing, chewing, chewing. Because gradually, gradually, our days are vanishing. Every single day that goes by, you can never get it back again. Can any multi-millionaire, billionaire pay, you know, $20 billion to buy back one day that just went by? No, no one can get it back. So in this way, the whole condition of life is full of all kinds of worries and miseries and troubles. But there is this little bit of honey that is dripping down. And we are trying to taste that honey, and when we taste that honey, we forget for a few moments. We think, oh, how sweet. What is that honey? Oh, the affection that we get from our family members, from our friends, from our loved ones. And we think that, oh, everything's fine, everything's fine. But has it become fine? Are we now in a different condition? No, same exact position. So Prahlad Maharaj taught such a vivid lesson to Hiranyakashipu, and he told him the only solution to this problem is that hitvatmapatam grihamandukupam, this dark well of materialistic life, should be at once given up, and one should at once take to the process of eternal service called bhakti yoga, whereby one can realize one's eternal relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, Supreme Absolute Truth. So, when Prahlad Maharaj told this to his father, Hiranyakashipu, suddenly, Hiranyakashipu thought, what is this? I'm hearing from my son? He has become influenced by persons who are devotees of God, of Vishnu? What is this? And he had a little smile on his face because he thought, just see how our enemies have infiltrated into our kingdom, and they have gone directly to my son secretly and taught them these things. So he thought, oh, okay. He called the teachers of Prahlad Maharaj, Shunda and Amarka, and he said, you should carefully protect this boy and make sure that he doesn't hear from any of these other persons about this spiritual knowledge. Make sure that he is protected and he learns only these materialistic subject matters. And at that time, Then he was again taken away from that place by his teachers and brought to school to learn so many subjects.
Thank you.
So, most unqualified to speak, so the Gurudev is ordering me to speak. So, for my own purification, I will try to say something. So, as Sri Padmanabha Maharaj has explained, Sri Padmanabha Maharaj returned to his school of demoniac teachers. Actually, our Srila Prabhupada, who founded the Krishna Consciousness Movement in the Western countries, he explained that the materialistic schools, they are like slaughterhouses. It means the children go in and they don't learn anything about the soul. They only learn materialistic subjects. There's no, in the universities you will not find a department of soul education. So, Sri Prahlad Maharaj, he went back to his school and he was again indoctrinated with the teachings of materialistic life. And after some time, he again returned to his father. And in the same type of situation, his father asked him, "Oh Prahlad Maharaj, what is the best thing you have learned at your school?" So we can see from this that actually scripture is a series of questions and answers. So Bhagavad Gita was spoken by Sri Krishna and he was answering the questions of Arjuna. Also Srimad Bhagavatam has so many questions and answers. So this process of inquiry, this is actually our Vedic scripture, is based on this process of inquiry, disciple to guru. So in this way, Prahlad Maharaj, he took advantage of this situation to educate his father, who was completely ignorant of spiritual subject matters. So he said, "Oh my dear Prahlad, what is the best thing you have learnt at school today in your time?" So Prahlad Maharaj replied, "Sravanam kirtanam Vishnu smaranam padanam padasevanam archanam vandanam dasyam sakyam atmanivedanam iti pumsa pita Vishnu bhaktis janna valakshana kriyati bhagavati adha tanmanye dita uttamah." So he said, that person who is most intelligent, that person surrenders to the Supreme Lord and to his spiritual master by these nine processes of bhakti. Now many people wonder, what is bhakti yoga? People think of yoga and they think of many types of stretching and bending and meditating and pranayama and this. But actually bhakti yoga consists of these nine processes. It means hearing about the transcendental pastimes of the Lord, chanting his glories, remembering those pastimes in meditation. It means worshipping the lotus feet of the Lord, offering puja to the Lord, or worship by different articles. Offering very beautiful prayers to the Lord. Means becoming the servant of the Lord, becoming the friend of the Lord, and completely offering oneself, atmanivedana, completely surrendering oneself to the lotus feet of the Lord. So Prahlad Maharaj is explaining to his father that that intelligent person who takes shelter of these nine processes, he can attain liberation and he is an intelligent person. So what is the meaning? We can understand that our material senses, they are limited. We can see certain form, we can see certain colors, we can hear certain sounds, but actually Krishna himself and the spiritual world, they are beyond our range of our mind and senses. So what to do? We have to practice spiritual life to purify those senses and understand, and from this process our senses become purified and we can understand what is the Supreme Absolute Truth. So by hearing about the pastimes of the Lord, we can our sense of hearing becomes purified. And actually in our state we cannot see anything spiritual. Like Srila Gurudev says, we cannot see the Lord, so what do we hear from such personalities as Srila Gurudev about the form and the pastimes of the Lord? So after hearing these wonderful glorification of the Lord, then also we can chant our psalms. This is the next part of the process, which actually purifies our consciousness. Then the next stage is remembering, sramana. It means meditating on what we have heard and chanted. We can then meditate. Up until the last process, which is atmanivedana, which means completely offering mind, body, and words at the lotus feet of the Lord. Because in this present time, we think, speaking for myself anyway, that I am this body, we are these bodies. And everything that is related to these bodies is ours. But actually the process of surrender means to reverse this idea. To mean that I am belong to the Supreme Lord. I do not belong to myself. I'm not this body. I'm a spirit soul and I belong to the Supreme Lord. And everything that belongs to me also belongs to Him and is for His service. So in this way, this process of Bhakti Yoga is performed by these nine limbs, ultimately purifying the consciousness so we can have some glimpse and some realization of our eternal spiritual nature. So I don't have any more to say. Excuse me, Vancha Kalpur Rudyas Chakra Prasanna.
So first of all, I offer my humble obeisances unlimited times to the lotus feet of my Paramahadita Guru Padma, Om Vishnu Paramahamsa Parivak Acharya, Jagatashri Srimad Bhakti Vedanta Narayana Goswami Maharas. I also offer my humble obeisances unto all the Acharyas in Arupanuru Guru Vaya, especially Param Gurudev, Nityananda Pratishtham, Shri Bhakti Pratyan Keshava Goswami Maharas, and Nityananda Pratishtham, Shri Bhakti Vedanta Swami Maharas. Then I offer my humble obeisances unto the Tridandi Swami's presence, all the senior Vaishnavas, God brothers, God sisters, guests. We have come here today to observe and celebrate the glorious appearance of Shri Srimadeva. So we're very lucky here coming together and observing this festival. Shri Gurudev has come all the way from India to remind us what is the reality of our situation in this world, that we have forgotten Krishna. As Shripad Padmanabhara so eloquently presented and explained what is our position in this world, we have forgotten who we really are. Even we are in the dark world of materialistic existence. Myself included. Yeah, I did not come in this world to look for Krishna. I came to look for material happiness. And then being in this world, we even don't think about crying out for God, but rather we cry out for honey, honey. Yeah. Where is honey? Yeah. Not only that, we are going to school. And what do we learn there in school? What is honey? Yeah. Money is honey. Yeah. Money, sweeter than honey, brighter than sunshine. Even in school, we learn about religion. Isn't it? We learn God is there, you have to pray to God, and anything you want, good health, lots of money and material happiness, pray to God and He will give it to you. Not only that, you pray to Him to forgive you for all your sinful activities, and when you walk out of the door, again you can engage in the same sinful activities. They made it so easy that once a year only you have to ask forgiveness for your sinful activities, and the rest of the year just go on. This is called education in religion nowadays. So this was also going on in this particular example and wonderful pastime that we are sharing with all of you tonight. Sri Prahlad Maharaj, the son of the greatest materialistic person on earth, Hiranyakashipu, who all the inhabitants of the whole universe were afraid of. He has performed austerities in order to become immortal. However, the one he asked for to become immortal was himself not able to provide that. So he thought of a trick how to become immortal, and he performed severe austerities for only that, to be in this world eternally and enjoy sense gratification. This is the inclination of all those who have made a vow to be in this world and to be happy with their family. Hiranyakashipu was dead determined to obtain this, and he was ready to fast and do anything to obtain this. Today, we are so lucky that by observing this festival, we are also having a great chance to obtain the reality of what is the relationship of our real self, the soul, with the Supreme Self, God or Sri Krishna. By observing a little austerity today, fasting up till the appearance of the up till the set of the sun, the sunset, we can obtain tremendous devotional benefit. Very difficult, one day only. Hiranyakashipu, 60,000 years, he was abstaining from food and so many things, standing on one leg, and fire coming from his crown, from his body, devastating the whole universe. And we only one day we can do, and we can obtain much more than Hiranyakashipu. We can obtain eternal love and affection for the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So Prahlad, he has the greatest fortune from even being in the womb of his mother, obtaining the association of Sri Narada Rishi, the Supreme Mahabhagavat devotee, eternal associate of Sri Krishna, instructing Prahlad, showering him with transcendental nectar. And Prahlad, he became so fixed in his relationship of devotion to the Supreme Lord that even the greatest materialist, the greatest asura Aldi in the universe could not waver his determination. So here, Hiranyakashipu just asked Prahlad, what is the best thing that you have learned? And as we heard from Shripad Madhu Radha Prabhu, how these nine activities, Prahlad says, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu, Smaranam, Achanam, Badanam, Darsham, Satyam, Atmani, Hedanam. These nine activities, if we apply them to Vishnu and to Ashraya Vishnu, Bhagavan, Ashraya Bhagavan, to Sri Krishna and to the spiritual master, then this is the best knowledge that you can learn. So Prahlad, he went to the school of Sandarnamarga, the sons of Shukracharya, who was the spiritual master for all materialistic persons, who was the spiritual instructor, so-called, between brackets, of Hiranyakashipu, spiritual, between brackets, because really spiritual, as we will learn tonight in this discourse, is something which is very, very special. It's not an ordinary thing. Oh, I'm practicing spiritual life, I'm doing some exercises, and I accept that God is within me and within all of us, and we should be in harmony with everyone. No! These 9 activities, if we apply them properly, under the guidance of a pure, spiritual, self-realized guru, spiritual master, who himself is completely detached from anything in this world, has completely realized the essence of all transcendental literatures, the Vedas, and who is immersed, yeah, with so much mood in serving his Ishtadev, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So Prahlad, he had obtained this great fortune from his spiritual master, Sinara Darishi. And he himself was completely in mood, in bhav, always remembering his Ishtadev, always absorbed in serving him by his remembrance. And here his demoniac father asking him again, what is the best thing that you have learned in school? When he heard this, Hiranyakashipu, his eyes started rolling. What is this? When did Prahlad learn this? He became very, very disturbed. Then he said, he looked at Prahlad. How is this possible? Yeah. Then Prahlad said, Matirna Krishna Parataksato va mito vipatyate griha bratanam adanta gopi visitam tamisham puna puna stagvita charvananam. So my dear father, those who have made a vow to be in this world, griha bratanam, who have made a vow, I will stay in family life and be happy with my family members, my wife, my children, my little pets, yeah, my doggy, my catty, and my horses, yeah, and not only that, my beautiful boat, and my cars, yeah, and my little garden. And I have this big fridge there with all the goodies that I need in order to remain healthy. These people, they have no opportunity to fix their intelligence on the real beneficial thing for them, which is to remember Vishnu or Bhagavan. Not even if they try to discuss this matter with each other. Yeah? If they have made this vow, I will be happy in this world, they can never be, yeah, inclined towards the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And what do? Their senses are completely immersed, completely entangled, yeah, in this material world. Always thinking, where is money? Sweeter than honey, brighter than sunshine. How can I provide enough money so that my family is happy? Yeah. Sometimes I may also give some donation to the priest when he comes, yeah, to get rid of all the reactions of my sinful activities. But really, I want to remain with my family. They can never attain the shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Prahlad was telling. Yeah. And what are they engaged in? Purna Charvita Charvananam. Chewing that, which has already been chewed so many times. Srila Gurudev very much reminds us always the dogs in India. Some of you have been to India. Here we may not see that because all the dogs are on leash. People have to take them on leash in the park, on the road, and they have to carry a little plastic bag to pick up the whatever remnants they leave behind. Yeah. But in India, if you go to India, you will see all the dogs running around freely on the road, sometimes 40, 50 at a time, whole bunches. Yeah. And the amazing thing is, yeah, if one of them discovers some piece of bone, yeah, anywhere in the earth or in some corner, and he grabs that piece of bone and he tries to chew it to get some good taste, some sweet taste, yeah, then what happens? That bone is already, yeah, been chewed up and rejected by other dogs. Okay? And he picks it up and he chews it, and what happens? He hurts his gums and he chews some blood and he thinks, how nice this tastes. Then he tries to protect the bone, tries to run away with it, but little or no, what happens? 40 dogs are running behind him. They all want to catch that bone. Yeah? And that ball is so heavy that he is losing speed and the 40 dogs come and catch him. Yeah? So big fight, and another one takes that ball and tries to chew it. And this goes on. This is like chewing that which has already been chewed so many times before. So what is that in our situation? We say, well, we're like those dogs. We're not like those dogs. We are human beings. Yeah. We are respected in society. Yeah? We have family. We are not doing these things. But if you use your intelligence, if we use our intelligence, then what are we doing? Yeah? What did our grandfather do? Grandfather got married with grandmother, right? They had so many children, or maybe not so many, but they had children. They had dogs and animals. Our mom or dad, they did the same thing. They got married and we were the happy family members. Yeah? And what happens in our family? What happens in the family of our grandfather, our great-grandfather, our great-great-grandfather? Did they obtain any permanent happiness? What were they chewing? Yeah. What was it that they were chewing? As Sripad Bhattacharya has explained, a few drops of honey, yeah, hanging on the branches, the tiger, death is roaring, so many snakes are hissing, yeah, all the living entities, our neighbors, our friends, who sometimes say, I'm your friend, and the next moment they say, I hate you. Isn't it true? Or even our own family members, our children, they say, Daddy, I don't like you at all. Yeah. And he might say even worse things. Yeah. I remember in my family life, with my daddy and mommy, I was sometimes getting so frustrated that I couldn't do anything. Sometimes with brothers and sisters, what is the happiness which we are discussing here? It is the same chewing that bone. Yeah? Nobody in history has ever achieved permanent happiness by trying to immerse themselves in family life. There's no example. Yeah? Only when one wakes up and obtains that his intelligence and his all attention becomes fixed on the Supreme Personality of God, and only then those personalities have obtained permanent happiness. Great sages, saintly personalities, spiritual masters, as we are so lucky to be in their presence today, of our beloved spiritual master, they have obtained eternal happiness. They are no longer interested in material family life. They are now trying to increase the family of Sri Krishna, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. All of us, who are we? Jivena Swarupahai Krishna Nitya Das. We are, according to our constitutional nature, all brothers and sisters. And we have the same father. Yeah? But we have forgotten. And Gurudev so kindly travels all over the world in advanced age to remind us we are all one family. Give up this duality that you think we belong to this world. We are men, we are women, we are beautiful, we are ugly, we are old, we are young, we are intelligent, we are smart, we are dumb. No, we're American, we're European, we're Indian. We are all spirit, soul, and we have an eternal constitutional identity, which is meant to be happy forever when it realizes its potential and nourishes that potential and realizes its beautiful relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So Prahlad, he's telling his father, Father, it's not possible for you, yeah? Not possible for anyone who has made a vow to be in this world and be happy in family life, yeah? You're bound to be engaged in chewing that which you have been chewed for, which has been chewed for so many times before. Then he goes on, he said, Nateni vidu swatakatin hi vishnu. Those who have not made in their life the firm determination to choose that the goal of my life is to realize who is God, who am I, what is my relationship with God. They are bound, yeah, to be distracted and guided by those who are spiritually blind, who have no vision, who are materially inclined. Yeah. And what will they do? A person who's blind, he wants guidance. We don't know who is God. We don't know who we are. What is our relationship with God? We want guidance. But we have not made the object of our life to obtain that any relationship. Yeah. We are worried about this world, how to be happy. What do? We obtain some guidance from someone who says, I know how to make you happy. Santa Marka, listen to me, Prahlad. Lots of money, give you lots of money. Yeah. It will make your life very happy. You can buy the things you need in order to satisfy your senses. And all you do some religious activities in order to ask God, please God, give me money, make me happy. So this process is being taught nowadays in the world, yeah, in modern day education. How to be religious, how to obtain sense gratification, dharma, artha, karma, moksha, yeah, how to obtain economic development. The whole world is proud, especially American leaders, they're very proud. We are doing wonderful. Our democracy is the example for the whole world. We have to convince everyone to accept democracy. And what's happening? Yeah. All are running around. Yeah. Intoxicated by the objects of the senses, intoxicated by the drugs which they need to take in order to avoid to become obese and so many other things. Isn't it? To get rid of one drug, they have to take another drug. Yeah. To avoid becoming old age, they have to go to the hospital to get an operation. So many things are going on in the world in the name of education. So Prahlad is telling here, my dear father, those persons who do not have embraced the ultimate goal to obtain, realize their relationship with Sri Bhagavan, yeah, they are guided. Like a blind person is guided by another blind person, accepting him as his leader. And what happens? Both of them fall in a ditch. There is no other opportunity. Yeah. So what Prahlad is telling his father, Father, there is one hope. Yeah. And this, as we heard, this is an instruction for all of us. The pastimes of the Supreme Lord and his beloved associates, which we hear from Srimad Bhagavatam, yeah, they are teachings for all of us. So Prahlad is telling Father, there is only one hope for those persons who are determined to rot in this material world. Yeah, we have family, yeah, trying to be happy. There is one opportunity for you, he says, and that is the only solution, the only way to solve, to rescue yourself and to become happy forever. What is that solution? Have to smear the lotus dust, have to roll in the lotus dust of the pure servant of Sri Krishna, the pure servant of God, the pure devotee, Sadguru. If we want to obtain freedom from our entanglement in this world, there is only one solution. We have to take the dust of the lotus feet of the pure devotee, smear it all over our body, again and again and again. Roll in the food dust. What does it really mean? It means we have to accept his guidance, his shelter. This is the first principle of bhajan, yeah? To accept complete shelter at the lotus feet of the spiritual master. And be sure that you have, yeah, the conviction in your heart that he is my everything. For him, yeah, I am engaged in these processes, hearing, chanting, remembering, worshipping, praying, becoming his servant, becoming his friend, and surrender my everything, my words, my body, my activities, at his lotus feet. This golden opportunity is there for all. And this is the only medicine which will free us from this material world. So Prahlad is telling to his father like this. His father, oh, he's becoming more and more upset. What is this? He says, this boy, talking about Vishnu, yeah, who has killed my brother, Hiranyaksha. Yeah. He has become the enemy, my very son. Yeah. what's going to happen with me? He's thinking, the enemy has intruded. Sandana Marga, he calls his teachers again. What happened? Why did you teach him like this? Oh, no, 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 we are, don't offend us. Yeah, we are Brahmins. Yeah, Sandana Marga told him, my school. Don't offend us, we are Brahmins. We have never told him where he got it. We don't know. We have only told him how to be expert in Dharma, in Artha, and in Kam. Yeah? Sense enjoyment, religious activities, and economic development. We have never told him anything about Vishnu. Yeah? Oh, he's becoming more and more angry. Guards! Hiranyakashipu is calling his guards. Take your weapons! Prahlada, very small boy, 5 years old, you can imagine. They come with big choppers. His guards, take their weapons. Kill him! So Prahlada sitting there, remembering Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Always absorbed in remembrance. Guards try to chop him. Nothing happens. Hiranyakashipu is thinking, what's this? Baby! Baby, this is my end. He's becoming very, very worried. I am immortal. But this Prahlada, he is the representative of the enemy, Vishnu. And nothing, I cannot do anything to him. He doesn't accept my teaching. He's immune to anything. Wait a minute, he thinks. Guards, bring the elephants. Bring boiling hot oil. Yeah. Not only that, take this Prahlada, throw him off the cliff. Yeah. Boil him in oil. Trample him under the feet of the elephants. So many others. And then, Hiranyakashipu goes, Prahlada, nothing happens. He is always remembering the Supreme Lord and nothing can kill him. Nothing even slightly injured. Oh, Hiranyakashipu, who is the controller of the whole universe? All living entities are feeding him. Cannot control. This little boy. Beyond my control. And his mind becomes completely agitated. Then, who comes in? Sister of Hiranyakashipu. Monika, her name is Monika. She said, brother, don't worry. I'll take care of this. Monika, like all the asuras or demoniac materialistic persons, they have some cities, mystic cities. Nowadays people can control by some materialistic cities and do so many things, hypnotize people and manipulate them, make them believe that what they say is the correct thing. But in the past they had very powerful mystic cities, previous yuga. So Holika is telling, brother, don't worry. Yeah. She had a city that she could create fire, and if she would walk in the fire, fire would not hurt her. So, blazing fire, Monika takes Prahlada on her arms and goes in the fire. What happens? Prahlada comes out. And Monika?
Finished.
Yeah. So, how now, Hiranyakashipu? Completely. He's at the end. What to do, what to do? Then his two teachers are coming, Sandana Marga. Master, don't worry. He's only a small boy, he can't hurt you, he's only 5 years old, he's still, we can still change his nature. Oh, when they're small, when boys are small and girls are small, you can change their nature.
Or father sometimes.
So he's telling Sandana Marga, we will change this boy very soon, our father is coming, Sukracharya. And with his help, we will make his son ideal demon. Ideally, this materialistic person. We will teach him, yeah, very firmly. We will make sure that nothing can influence him anymore. And he will be your most beloved, yeah, son. A super materialistic son. So I think that others, well,
yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Please be seated. They will be right back now. So don't stand up from your seat. We will come back in a few minutes. So first of all, I give my humble obeisances to the lotus feet of my spiritual master, Om Vishnupad Astodar Sadasusumad Bhakti Vedanta Swabha Ananda Swami Maharaj and Om Vishnupad Parivrajak Acharya Varja Astodar Sadasumad Bhakti Vedanta Swabha Narayana Swami Maharaj. I pay my obeisances my spiritual grandsire Nitya Lila Purushottam Vishnupad Srila Bhakti Pragyan Keshava Goswami Maharaj and Nitya Lila Purushottam Vishnupad Srila Bhakti Vedanta Swami Maharaj. I give my obeisances to all Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis headed by Sri Padmanabha Maharaj and disciple of Sri Bhakti Swami Maharaj. So, you have heard just now from the life history of Prahlad Maharaj. A very one devotee is there. He is protected by God. God means Jiva generator, Upar operator, Jiva destroyer. When he is protected by God, none can make harm of him. You have seen, you have heard just now that Hiranyakashipu, he is just like almost immortal. None can make harm of him. Not only that, he knows so many illusions to make so many, create so many things. Again, can destroy this thing, that thing. And Prahlad Maharaj, only 5 years aged boy, what he can know all this thing? Hiranyakashipu is goal of his life that my son must learn hypocrisy, duplicity, diplomacy, all this thing. But Prahlad Maharaj is pure devotee of God. He has nothing to do with this diplomacy, duplicity, hypocrisy, all these things. He don't like all these things, all these crazy things. So, Prahlad Maharaj, when he's chatting about Vishnu, Janusar told, wow, he is my enemy, he is killer of my brother, and he is taking side of that Vishnu. He is blasting our family. Just like if you want to cut a tree with an axe, axe need one handle. So Hiranyakashipu is telling, Vishnu is axe here, and this boy helping him like a handle. Without handle, he could not cut a tree. So Prahlad is handle to assist Vishnu. So somehow or other, we have to kill him. When Hiranyakashipu tried at his level best to kill him, but could not do so. Each and every time became completely failure. Then he keep his face down, sitting on his throne. Oh my goodness. What to do? It's only merely 5 years boy. I gave him birth. I could not even kill this boy. Then Sandar Amaka told, oh my dear master, why not sorry? Even seeing you on your eyebrow, demigods begin to tremble. If you walk really angry, then earthquake start, like it happened just like in China. And if you run, just like it's like a hurricane, like it happened in Burma. So, why so worried for this? Be calm and quiet. My father went for very big austerity. Why did he come back? As a moment he can change his body. It's not so hard task. So, being a great king, you are so worried. Nothing to worry for this boy. Let us take him away from here. When my father will come, he will be controlled by my father. Don't worry. Okay. He was thinking, oh, maybe this is my end. Why I became failure? But what maybe Sandar Amaka told to take him? They took him in Gurukul again. And they are teaching him religion, economics, politics, all these things. And
main thing. They are not aware for religion or salvation, mainly for self-gratification. For that you need money. So economic development is needed. But they don't know, we are not this physical body, we are spirit soul. If you have no soul, we'll enjoy this world. For whom you earn money, but they are not aware of this soul, only this physical body. They are teaching Prahlad, oh Prahlad, but when Prahlad is going to Gurukul, he became calm and quite very polite. What their teacher is telling, not opposing, but not accepting. Like he is taking 1 year and sending back another year, not listening anything. Always remembering about Vishnu. So, although nowadays American economy is going a little down, but still 70% of economy controlled by America. So Santa Barbara teaching him that dollar is dollar, brighter than solar. Dollar is dollar, cooler than lunar. Dollar is dollar. If you have a lot of dollars, then you are a great scholar. If you have no dollar, you are a big fooler. Dollar is dollar. One boy is so happy, the raise his hand, and oh, very cute, very nice. But Prahlad Maharaj, not listening anything at all. He's listening. Which, remembering which he has learned from Prahlad, sorry, Narad Rishi. Then some household work came, then two teachers, Sandra Mavarka, told Prahlad, we are going for a while, you can take care of this, your friends, as a monitor. So monitor system start in Satya Yuga, not in Kali Yuga, in Vedic period. So Prahlad, now he's taking care of the boys. As soon as teacher went inside, all the boys became very now free. None can say to them anything. Then, oh, chalo, let us play. Like you see, so many kids are playing. They are also 5 years, 6 years, 2 years, 3 years. They are very fond of play. Prahlad told, my dear friend, please listen to me. Because Prahlad is prince and he stopped in his class. So everybody bound to listen to him. Oh Prahlad, oh, Prahlad listen, let us listen something, we have to do bhajan. Hare Prahlad, forget it. Why you are so worried? We are now only, not even teenage, merely a boy, merely a child. When our old age will come, then we'll do bhajan. Why so worried? Aaj karo so kal karo so parso. Kyon khat khat mein padha hua yo jivan padha hai parso? Oh Prahlad, why you sorry? You'll do bhajan not today, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, our life will be so fast. Why sorry? Prahlad, why you no brother, none can say you will alive next day or not. So, what you want to do tomorrow, please do today. What you want to do today, do immediately for Krishna consciousness. For bad thing, you can, oh, battle tomorrow, day after tomorrow, like this. You can make it, postpone or lengthen and postpone it. So, okay Prahlad, what you are telling me, we'll listen to you. Then Prahlad told, Kaumarat acane prakmo dharman bhagavataniha durlabho manusa janma tadap padruvam arthadam. Prahlad Maharaj is telling, listen carefully. If you want to be even big man in this world, if you not learn from this young age, if you be old, then you can go to school, learn something. The demonic world, no, never. If learn from beginning. If you want to be a doctor, when you 60 years old, you can go to school to learn medical science, not possible. If you want to be a great engineer or attorney, if 70 years old, you go to school, learn. Law school, not possible at all. Same way, if you want to be successful in your life, you have to do your bhajan from young age. Kaumarat acharyat raghavam. We'll be intelligent enough, then do bhajan from young age. Dharman bhagavata durlabho. Why? They're asking Prahlad, why? Durlabho manasa janma. This human being is extremely rare. with uncontrolled sense, who have controlled their sense, they walk in daytime, after that drink something and fall asleep. If you think our lifespan about 100 years, about 50 years we spend only sleeping, bogus, nothing, only drink, work some, nothing to cook, go to a restaurant, drink something, and drink and sleep. You don't know what you are doing. After that, even 100 years, 50 years is done by sleeping only, and rest 50 years. When you are old age, 80 to 100 years, at that time, so old, even so many diseases attack you. And if you want to speak, mucus choke your voice. And you want to walk straight, have to take help of stick. And could not walk properly. So how you can do bhajan at that time? You could not do anything in your old age. You have been old house, even to whom you produce, to whom you give years of money to your children, even they will not come to see you. And the father day, hello daddy, how are you? That's enough, not more than that. And mostly they can send some power to you by post, not more than that. So what is the utility of this life if you not do bhajan? So 50 years by sleeping, 80 to 20, 100 years and 20 years, old age, and remain 30 years. In 30 years, if you want to be expert in any art, or any medical science, or anything, or you want to be a rock singer, then what to do, pop singer? Then minimum you need 20 years to be an expert. So 50 years sleeping, 20 years old age, and 20 years being an expert. So 50 plus 20 plus 20, 90. Remain only 10 years. At that time, you have unlimited desires. Oh, I have to marry, I have to produce children. I need so many nice cars, like Jaguar, limousine, this and that. If I have not so nice car, like BMW, something happened today this morning. So, none can care that I am a big guy. So all have you acquired in 10 years. Then when you do bhajan, if you do bhajan of Krishna, Sri Krishna from young age, then it will come in your habit, then you will not suffer any difficulties. After that, the demonic boy told, oh Prahlad, what is the process of Krishna consciousness? Then Prahlad had told, and they asked, oh Prahlad, from where we have learned all these things? Our teacher, Sundar Namarka, never explained all these things, all this philosophy. From where you have learned? You are same aged boy. Then Prahlad told his life history, which you have heard from Srimad Padmana Maharaj. When he was his mother womb, then he has learned everything from his guru, Narada Rishi. Then how to do bhajan, what is the process? Then Prahlad Maharaj replied, Guru Susu Saya Bhakta Sarvala Bharpani Nacha Sangyan Sadhu Bhaktana Isharadhani Nacha Guru Susu Saya Bhakta. If you want to advance in Krishna consciousness and you want to make your life successful, only in this world, eat, drink and be merry. By this you never be happy. Never, never, how much do you endeavor? Never. So must have to come into Krishna consciousness. So, Guru Susu Saya Bhakta, you have to be under guidance of spiritual teacher. Not only that Krishna bhajan, if you want to be expert in this world, you must have to adopt a teacher. You may call him professor, or teacher, preceptor, anything. But for this spiritual life, we have to accept a spiritual teacher. Guru Susya, Susya Saya Bhakta, and have to serve him with great honor. And Sarvala Bharpani Nacha, what you possess, you have to offer to your guru, which I have. We have nothing. When we come in this world, when we took birth, then our hand was closed. And you depart from this world, hand will be open. So you could not pick anything from here. When you take birth in this world, you brought your own karma with you and it will go back, which world and you have everything in behind. Everybody could not take every tip of hair from your body. What to say what you are dollar or euro or pound? Not possible to take with you. So, what he possessed? Our uncontrolled mind and our soul. If he offered to Srila Gurudev, what he will do? He will purify and offer to Divine Kapil, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Then life will be successful. Guru Sushru Seya Bhakta Sarva Lavhar Padi Nacha. And if you know why I go to Guru, like a mediator or broker, I can do by my bhajan. One bhajan, if you go in Google search, you can see so many mantras this and that. Oh, I can do bhajan. If you want to do bhajan this way, Bhagavan never accept you. Just like, if you want to have a job, big company, or if you advertise yourself, I'm intellectual giant computer, but you are not degree holder from a good university. If you apply, they will take your application. So in that abstract, because you are not degree holder from university. In same way, unless until you are not initiated by bona fide guru, bona fide teacher, Bhagavan will accept you, God will not accept you. So master initiated by a bona fide teacher, spiritual teacher. Guru Sushru Seya Bhakta Sarva Sanghena Sadha Bhukta, not only that. Have you always in good association? If you good association, just like you are going to school or college, but you have to coming back to homework, either your dad can help, your mommy can help, but homework have to do. In same way, Gurudev will give initiation, but how to practice? In good association, from Vaishnavas you can learn all these things. So Sanghena Sadhu Bhaktana Ishwara Radhanin. If you do so, then God will accept it, otherwise God will reject. There is so many examples, like Dhruva Maharaj wanted to do bhajan, but he has no guru at all. Then Bhagavan sent Naradrishi to initiate him. Then initiated by Naradrishi, then he achieved God. If you want to go direct, Bhagavan told himself, Prathamam tu gurum pujya tatascaiva mamarchanam tadesa bhagavad bhakti yannathanis phalom bhaved. What? If you want to do bhajan, then what to do? Prathamam tu gurum pujya, fast, worship and please your Gurudev. If you not do so, what will happen? Tatascaiva mamarchanam, then make him happy, take permission from him, then come to bhajan myself to God. If you do so, then you get devotion, otherwise everything go in vain. So same way, you have to be under guidance of Gurudev and be in good association. Then, how to do that? Then Prahlad Maharaj told, follow me. They're chanting. So what happened after that? We'll listen from Gurudev Lotus Tree. Hare Krishna. Bancha Bhagavataru Pascha Kutasa Gurudev Lotus Tree. advance earth and what he did?
Stop! Stop immediately! What is this chanting? Who do you think you are, Prahlad? Who has taught you this to make everyone chant this names of God? Who do you think you are, Prahlad, huh? Prahlad, do you think that your God can save you? Huh, Prahlad? Do you think he can save you?
Yes, my Lord, he can save me. And he can save you too.
Your God, this God that you talk about, you think that he's all powerful, but you don't know how powerful I am. Everyone is affrighted just by the movements of my eyebrows. Do you know that, Prahlad?
I know that, Dad, but your power is coming from the same source as my power, from
Vishnu. And where is your power coming from?
He is coming from Vishnu and he's everywhere, Dad.
Oh, really? Yes. Your God is everywhere?
He's everywhere.
Oh, then tell me, this pillar here, is your God in this pillar?
You won't believe it, but he's there, Dad. Try it out.
Okay. Let's see your God come and protect you now. I will smash this pillar with my bare hands and see if your God comes and protects you then, huh? Huh? Huh?
Go ahead, Dad.
Prahlad, oh,
I have done late. I could not come before. So I want that you should have any home. Then Prahlad Maharaj told, I am not a businessman. I have served you not for anything. So if I any desire is hidden in my heart, you should take it away. Then Nrisimhadev told, I know that you have no desire, but yet you should have any hope. Then he told, oh, my father has done so much offenses in your lotus feet and also in he has disturbed me. So please, oh, liberate my father. He told that, oh, it has been done. Those who are first class Vaishnava, Uttam Vaishnava, their father, mother in 21 generation, they will be liberated. And those who are in Madhyamadhikar, oh, their father, mother for 14 generation, they will be also. And those who are still in Kanishtadhikar, oh, their father, mother, for 7 generation, they will be liberated. So, don't worry for that. You should ask any another book. Then, Prahlad Maharaj told, I see that in this world, billions and millions of all jeeves are suffering in the pain of endless birth and death. They should be liberated. And for them, I will bear all these things and I will go to hell for lakhs and lakhs.
Marvelous.
Then he told Prahlad Maharaj, Prahlad, I am defeated by you. I can give you only that bone. That if anyone hear this sweet pastimes of you and between me, they will have pure bhakti and shortened, they will be liberated from this world. Gau Brahma! Jai Nrisimhadev ki jai! Gods began to pray him and he disappeared and demi gods also returned back to their abodes and then Prahlad Maharaj was given kingdom of all Hiranyakashipu state kingdom and he was very, very ideal bhakta. He began to honor all the rishis, maharshis, brahmins and bhaks. So, Vishnu cried, you have come here from so far away. Don't return back guilty. You should take some qualities of Prahlad Maharaj. Whatever suffering or happiness coming, you should happily test it. And always, in any stage you are, always chanting, remembering Krishna. Don't give up, don't be weak. I see that when we will go, so many will be weak. So you should not be. Always remember the sweet pastimes of Prahlad and Nrisimha and try to be tolerant like him, very, very humble, giving respect to another, not any desire to have any praise or anything from others. In this way, your life will be successful. Sisi Nrisimhadev ki jai! Yeah. Yeah.
to have a very short ceremony to conclude this evening's program, which is called Abhishek. It is a bathing ceremony, so you can observe here on the altar. We have a very beautiful deity of Lord Nrisingadev, and this deity is now going to be ceremonially bathed, and we will have the performance of kirtan while this bathing ceremony is going on. Shri Nrisingha Bhagavan Ki Jai, Bhakta Prabhu Shri Prahlad Maharaj Ki Jai, Gaur Premanande. Namaste Narasingaya. Namaste Narasingaya. Oh,